This is great. All right. Good evening, everyone. I'm delighted to speak to you tonight in honor of the holiday of Purim, which falls exactly 1 week from tonight. Before I begin, I'd like to thank Ellen Silverstein, a board member of your shul, for inviting me to speak tonight to bring to you an exciting view of Megillat Esther. Thank you too to Margie Siegel, tonight's Zoom master, to Jill Slater, and to the Stanton Street Shul Executive Committee board members for making tonight's lecture a reality. My topic for tonight is Solving Mysteries in Megillat Esther, Whatever Happened to Vashti. For the first part of our hour together, I will discuss biblical storytelling, the historical and literary context of the Megillah, and I will talk about the different approaches of the Jerusalem and Babylonian Talmuds to Vashti and to the rabbinic legends surrounding her fate. Then I will do a reading from my latest book, The Queen and the Spymaster, from the chapter that retells the story of Vashti and that solves tonight's biblical mystery. The bit of housekeeping that I was going to inform you all of, Margie's already taken care of. Everyone will be muted on because it's a Zoom talk. And at the end, we'll open it up to questions, if you wouldn't mind submitting your questions to the chat. Well, all right, let's begin. We all love a good story. A good story can seize our attention, fire our imagination, and arouse our emotions. We can tumble into love, grit our teeth in anger, tremble with fear, charge into battle, and all without leaving our seats. The Bible stories in particular have fascinated me from the time I could hold a book. How many of us have memories of listening to our parents and earliest teachers, reading to us the adventures of Lot's wife turned to salt, of Jacob tricking his brother and father for the birthright, of Moses and the 10 plagues in the land of the Pharaohs, of Miriam's magic well of water in the wilderness, of Joshua and the tumbling walls of Jericho, of Ruth, a migrant widow from Moab, seducing a tribal chief of Judah, of Esther in the palace of the king of Persia. The list of Bible stories that moves us is long and thrilling. And if we are lucky, we never outgrow this love of the story. Have you ever noticed that two of Judaism's major holidays revolve around the telling or reading of a story? For Pesach, we have the Haggadah, which literally means the telling. For Purim, we have Megillat Esther, the scroll or book of Esther. And telling these stories at their appointed time of the year is even elevated to the level of performing a mitzvah or a requirement in order that we fully experience these important holidays. For Pesach, we discuss and retell the story of the Exodus from Egypt. And we're even told that he or she who embellishes and examines the Exodus story the most while sitting at the Passover Seder, that person is considered praiseworthy. Hare ze meshubach. Similarly, at Purim, it is a mitzvah to hear every word of Megillat Esther read out loud, both on the evening of Purim and on the day of the holiday. In chapter 9 of the Megillah, we read that Mordechai and Esther instituted the annual holiday of Purim, commemorating the reversal of Haman's plot to obliterate Persia's Jews, and authorized merrymaking, the giving of charity, and the annual retelling of the story of the Jews' victory over Haman. In fact, the Megillah tells us in chapter 9 that Mordechai wrote down the story of the Jews' near brush with genocide in Sefarim, which literally means books, but was probably scrolls in 5th century BCE Persia. And he dispatched these Sefarim to all the Jews spread throughout the Persian Empire, encompassing about 2 million square miles. No doubt the story was intended not only to bolster the far-flung Persian Jews, but also to serve as an implicit warning to any nascent enemies that the Jews, fresh from victory, were not to be trifled with. And this writing down of the story in Sefarim was a brilliant move, as it endures until today in the form of Megillat Esther. So Purim, a basically terrifying but triumphant tale, as are most good stories, is a crowd-pleasing favorite, and we begin to appreciate the power of biblical storytelling. But we might ask ourselves, why does the Bible even tell stories? Since the Torah is a book of law, the very word Torah means to teach, why not just list God's rules and laws? Why include the story narratives at all? There must be something very powerful and vital in the telling of human stories for the Bible to place them front and center. The entire book of Genesis, the first book in the Bible, is one story after another. And there are stories that grab us. Often, they are the stories of failures and mistakes and of the human consequences of these mistakes. Consider the story of a heartbreaking exile from Eden, or the story of a single moment of passion when one brother kills another and the sin of fratricide is born, of kidnappings by princes and kings, of beautiful maiden daughters and married women, the story of the great flood, of Noah's vineyard and his drunkenness, the story of the sin of the golden calf. The stories, too, of the many great battles of Israel against Sidon, Amalek, Edom, Moab, Aram, and the Philistines. There are stories of greed and madness and evil. The Bible also tells stories of unlikely triumphs, stories that make us cheer, of Sarah's narrow escape from a Pharaoh bent on rape, of the barren Rachel finally giving birth, of Judah's recognizing his mistakes and speaking up to save his daughter-in-law Tamar from being burnt at the stake, of the splitting of the Red Sea, of the heroism of women named Miriam, Devorah, and Yael. Stories of victories of the few over the many, of the beautiful and innocent over the calculatedly cruel, of God's overt and often hidden hand. Oh yes, we can see why these stories populate the Bible. Rabbi Jonathan Sacks of blessed memory offers a reason for this. In two words, moral empathy. Rabbi Sacks says that empathy is structured into the way that the Torah tells its stories. About Hagar and Ishmael, when they're sent away into the baking desert with just one skin of water. About Esav, who cries helplessly when he enters his father's presence to receive his blessing, only to find that his brother has taken it by trickery. And about Leah's feelings of misery when she realizes that she is hated, that Jacob loves her sister Rachel more than her. These stories force us to recognize and confront our and others' humanity. In reading and telling these stories, we force ourselves to stand in the shoes of the unloved, unchosen, and rejected. These stories rouse us to champion those who are betrayed, preyed upon, or forgotten. Rabbi Joseph B. Soloveitchik, the towering Torah intellect of the 20th century, has taught that indeed, and perhaps counterintuitively, the Bible's stories teach us much. This is because within the stories of Genesis, of the Megillot, of Exodus, lies the inherent power to teach us, to recognize what's good, to strategize, and to galvanize us to champion what is right. After all, says Rabbi Sacks, that is how God acts and how he wants us to act. Narrative or storytelling is the most powerful way in which we enter imaginatively into the inner world of ourselves and other people. All of which brings me to my new book. In this, my fourth book, I've created an historical novel, a rich story based on the story of Esther. The Book of Esther, the Megillah, outlines the story of an orphan girl who wins a beauty contest and becomes queen of Persia, saving her people from a genocide. There, I've told the story of the Megillah in 20 words, but of course, not. That bare, insufficient outline only whets our desire to know more. The more we read Megillat Esther, the more we realize that the Bible's story of Esther leaves intentional gaps in its telling. And it is in the exploration of these gaps that we find adventure, magic, intrigue, ingenuity, evil, abiding good, romance, and even God. Fascinated by the story of Esther, I have many questions. I'm sure you do, too. Where did this orphan girl come from? Why is the king of Persia even looking for a new queen? What happened to Vashti, the prior queen? Why did she defy the king, courting death? Is she executed, or does she survive the king's wrath? Who is this man, Mordechai, who raises the orphan girl who is destined to be queen? What is the true relationship between them? We know they are first cousins, but could they perhaps also be husband and wife, as the Talmud suggests? Who is this man, Haman? Could there be a deep ancestral reason for his intense hatred of Mordechai and his people? What is the true nature of the poor, the lot that Haman casts to determine the date of the genocide? Who is the man Xerxes, king of all Persia, who loses one queen, finds another, and allows himself to be manipulated by a corrupt vizier? How does a sheltered orphan girl manage to beat out every other beauty in the vast Persian Empire to win the king's heart and the coveted crown? Does Mordechai have a master plan? Ensconced within the corridors of palace power, is he a collaborator, an opportunist, a troublemaker? The Talmud raises all these questions about him. Or is Mordechai someone other than the man he seems? There are literally scores of questions I would ask of the Megillah. And in my new book, The Queen and the Spymaster, I did just that. Staying true to the text of the Megillah, I've retold the story of Esther as a novel, asking and answering these questions and many more besides. I invite you to enter the world of 5th century BCE Persia, a world of intrigue, secrets, and danger. Enter the fortress city of Susa, the imperial palace, and the royal harem, where truth wears a mask. Inhabit a royal court populated by an intricate shadow world of spies, informants, and assassins. Meet a sinister brotherhood with orders to draw a target on the king's back. Rival cabinet ministers who command private armies. An orphan girl with a gift for languages and an innate political intuition. A queen who, unbeknownst to all, is a secret agent in place, and the brilliant tactician who controls her. And ask yourselves one more question. How does a peaceable population of Persian Jewish merchants, farmers, shopkeepers, and politicians turn itself into a fighting force sufficient to defeat a trained army paid to obliterate them? As you can see, there are rich, untold stories here, begging to be told. The Megillah functions as the outline, if you will, intentionally leaving gaps in its telling of the story. Israeli professor of Bible, Meir Sternberg, in his book, The Poetics of Biblical Narrative, has said that the Bible's gaps are intentional, inviting these and countless other questions. I think of these gaps as keyholes. Imagine me, figuratively speaking, peering through each of these keyholes in the story of Esther. On the other side of those keyholes, I can see and imagine an entire world, a new and original backstory to the biblical story of the Megillah. I invite you to join me tonight on a 2,000-year journey through these keyholes, opening the doors into a thrilling original tale of the stories behind the story of Esther, telling the Esther story you never knew. Tonight's keyhole question, or Megillah mystery, makes it sound like a PBS special, is whatever happened to Vashti? Why does Queen Vashti defy the king, courting death? Ask yourselves this. Was this the first time in her 12-year tenure that the king had asked Queen Vashti to dance for his guests? Probably not. Why then does she defy him now? And what happens to her? Is she executed, or does she escape the hangman? The text of the Megillah, never shy of recounting hangings, impalings, and violent deaths in hand-to-hand combat, is strangely silent about this. Vashti simply disappears from the narrative, but we must know what happens to her. It is important to appreciate that the Megillah invites us to respectfully speculate about its ambiguities. Whole libraries are filled with volumes of Midrashim, medieval and modern, filling in the ambiguities of Megillat Esther. Even the two great Talmud compendiums, the Talmud Yerushalmi, or Jerusalem or Palestinian Talmud, and the Talmud Bavli, the Babylonian Talmud, differ utterly in how they treat Vashti. The Jerusalem Talmud came first, compiled in about the year of 300 by scholars in the land of Israel, about 200 years before the compilation of the Talmud Bavli. The Talmud Bavli, compiled later by scholars in exile in Babylon, was codified probably in about the year 500 CE. As you might imagine, because they were compiled by different rabbis, experiencing law and society in different countries and in different epochs, the Jerusalem and Babylonian Talmuds differ in many respects. It's important when analyzing discussions in each Talmud to bear in mind that one was compiled by rabbis living in the land of Israel, and the other was compiled by centuries later by rabbis living in exile, in a diaspora. And so quite simply, their worldviews differed radically. For our purposes tonight, one point of difference between the two Talmuds is the way each Talmud views Vashti. We always begin our discussion with the text of the Megillah itself. And so from the Megillah, we know several things about Vashti from the very beginning in chapter one. First, we know that Vashti is Tovat Mar'eh, possessing a beautiful figure. Second, that she made a separate party for the women. Third, the Megillah tells us that Vashti refuses the king's summons to dance at his private after party for his drunken guests. And importantly, the Megillah does not characterize Vashti as a good or evil queen, nor does it tell us what befell her after she defied the king's summons. The Talmudic Agadot, or legends, fill in some of the blanks. In the Jerusalem Talmud, and this may surprise you, Vashti is portrayed in a positive manner. In fact, the name Vashti in Parsi means beauty and goodness. She is a daughter of royalty, comports herself with honor, and living up to her name, is wise as well as beautiful. We do not know her fate. The implication drawn from the text of the Megillah by the rabbis of the Jerusalem Talmud is that Vashti was banished from the royal court for her insubordination. In contrast, by the time of the Babylonian Talmud, written in exile, remember that, 150 to 200 years later, the Bavli has shed any of the Jerusalem Talmud's positive aspects of Vashti. The rabbis of the Bavli portray her instead as a foil for Esther. Vashti is depicted in the Talmud Bavli legends as an evil queen, possessing a dragon's tail, skin lesions, scales, and pimples, even leprosy. This Vashti is predictably killed off. But the Talmudic Agadot also tell us about a Babylonian princess named Vashti who falls in love with a stable groom. And we are fascinated. Who is Vashti and what happens to her? Whatever the reasons for the rabbis' differing views of Vashti, the important takeaway for us is that there is not a single monolithic view of Xerxes' first queen. Megillah does not tell us what happens to Vashti. This is a gap in the story. In this light, let's read together the story of Vashti from the queen and the spymaster. Watch for the interweavings of Talmudic legends into this retelling. Here we go. I'll give you a glimpse, if you haven't seen it, of the book cover. You see, Esther is partly shrouded in shadow, That's a metaphor for the mysteries of the Megillat. Fell in love with the book cover the most. All right. The time is 50 years before Xerxes Persia, in the 6th century BCE. The chapter is entitled Vashti Beginnings in the Palace of King Belshazzar of Babylonia. The palace was burning. The noise was deafening, but blessedly still distant from her chambers. The girl Mahin could hear smashings, clashing of weapons, shouts of men, horses neighing, clangs of shod hooves over stone, and over everything, women's screams. The smoke and smell of burning fabric, wood, and flesh hung in a low cloud, even in this far corner of the women's palace in her secluded nursery. The girl cowered on her small bed and watched Razma, her aged handmaid, quickly and methodically pack 2 traveling sacks. Mahin's eyes were wide with terror. She was King Belshazzar's daughter, child princess of Babylonia, and on this night, she would become an orphan, a fugitive, and a prize. The impossible had happened. The Persians had invaded Babylonia, and Cyrus the Persian would soon rule supreme over a kingdom that had never known Persian domination. Razma had heard whisperings of the rapine horrors of the Persian invaders, and so she did what she was born to do. She protected her royal charge with her life and planned their escape. The princess's eunuch, a pensioned warrior guard, had handed Razma a sheathed dagger before running for the horses. "Use this if you must," he whispered to his old friend. "I will be back. Listen for me under the window and be ready." Then he was gone. Razma finished her packing and dragged the 2 belted bags onto the balcony that faced a garden courtyard. She wrapped Mahin in a hooded traveling cloak and carried her to the balcony stairs to await the guard. Razma trembled, or was it Mahin? The 2 of them, child princess and protector, waited in the smoky darkness, watching the flames rising into the night sky above the king's palace in the near distance. Razma's straining ears heard shufflings below. The eunuch had come back for them. He rounded the corner, leading 2 saddled horses, their hooves wrapped to muffle any sound, their heads and muzzles sheathed in burlap to prevent their panicking. "Come, they are searching for her now." In a matter of moments, the 3 were gone, the princess's small form blending into the shape of the travel sacks atop the horses. Young Mahin, tightly held by Razma, had been warned not to make a sound, and the obedient princess kept her eyes shut tight and her own screams inside her head. The fugitives, led by the eunuch, an old hand at military campaigning, took advantage of the chaos in the palace and the capital city of Babylon to evade Cyrus's search parties. In the way of victorious armies since the advent of war, the vanquished or dead king's daughter was universally sought, either for display, abuse, or ransom, or, if she was a beauty or could be of some use, to be wed to the victorious king as a token of goodwill. The eunuch and the princess's handmaid, prudently assuming the worst, were intent on spiriting the king's daughter to safety. For 3 days, the eunuch drove the horses northwestward in the general direction of Assur. His thought was to seek asylum with Belshazzar's royal allies in the vicinity of Assyria. Unfortunately for Mahin, her days of freedom were to be short-lived. Cyrus, an energetic, clever, and determined conqueror, hunted the fugitive princess himself, and by thinking like the old eunuch, Cyrus soon picked up their trail. Things moved quickly after that. Once caught, the princess and her 2 guardians had drawn the Persian king's admiration. The eunuch and the handmaid had held their weapons in steady hands, and likewise their young charge stood unflinching before Cyrus and his soldiers. When Cyrus pushed the princess's hood onto her shoulders, he could see that the terrified but silent girl held the promise of character and some beauty. In a magnanimous gesture he was never to regret, He spared the lives of the princess and her guardians and took the girl into his palace to groom as his future bride. In this way, Princess Mahin of Babylonia grew to young womanhood and became Persian bride and queen to Cyrus the Great. Years later, her own youngest daughter, Samar, married the king's prized general, and her daughter, granddaughter of Queen Mahin, wife of Cyrus the Great, would be named Vashti. Flash forward now, 50 years. The year is 483 BCE, year 3 in the reign of King Xerxes, aka Ahasuerus. Queen Vashti was no longer young, but even at 30 years old, most would say she was at the height of her physical beauty. Maintaining her figure, her dancing musculature, her hair, and her skin took up most of her time. Plus, she had half a kingdom's riches at her disposal and ostensibly everything she could desire. Servants, jewels, and clothing. Plus, she was consort to a powerful king. What she pined for, however, was what had been denied her. She had no child. Vashti, whose name in Parsi meant beauty and goodness, had come to her political marriage with reasonable expectations. She would become wife to Xerxes, joining their two peoples, Babylonians and Persians, and in time she would produce an heir to cement that union. She would age with beauty and respect and would gracefully reign over the house of the women as queen mother. But she had not reckoned on Xerxes' appetites. The king, once he discovered that Vashti was a superb and graceful dancer with a matchless figure, took care. He did not intend for his wife to become pregnant. And he intended for the time being to keep the status quo. Vashti had come to Xerxes 12 years earlier with a dowry from her royal mother and grandmother. One of Razma's hastily packed travel bags that long ago night had contained a queen's ransom, and Razma had added to it, hidden it, and guarded it fiercely so that with the passage of decades, its value and weight had increased. Vashti's personal fortune, a treasure box of golden coins, a small case of jewels, her clothing, her royal maids, her personal eunuch, and a beloved mare and stallion, were kept close within the queen's wing of the women's compound. In a kingdom as splendidly rich as Persia, the queen's wealth, quietly held, was subsumed to the king's grand displays. It was easily overlooked and forgotten. The other prize that Vashti had brought with her to Xerxes' palace was a knowledge and understanding of power. She had learned this from her father, Xerxes' prized general, just as she had learned from him how to ride like a Persian horseman. The general had been charmed by his athletic young daughter, who was an elegant and natural rider, eager to learn, and even as a girl, she moved as one with the horses. The young Vashti had shadowed her father whenever he was not campaigning with the king's troops. Some would say the lessons of power well learned held more value than gold coins or sparkling jewels. And as the twin to true power was often loyalty, another of Vashti's father's gifts to her was the transferred loyalty of his personal aides. The day was coming when Vashti's fortune would save her life. Vashti came to crave time away from the house of the women. The concubines snickered about her, and some even turned their backs on her in silent derision. It was an open secret that Vashti yearned for a child, but that Xerxes had other uses for her. This devalued Vashti in the eyes of the other women. Added to this, after her father's recent death, Vashti found herself missing his strong presence at her back. She found herself without a defender. She was utterly alone, except for her longtime handmaids and her eunuch bodyguard. She felt as if she was suffocating, living out her days in a hostile cage. If only she had had a child to love, she would have been content. But as things stood, Vashti, queen of all Persia, was guarded at every moment of every day. It may have been a soft guard, to be sure, but the house of the women had decorated iron lattices on its windows. Vashti discovered her sole moments of freedom lay while riding her beloved horses, especially now that she was missing her father so. At sunup every day, Vashti, accompanied by her eunuch guard, walked to the small stables with the women within the women's compound. Her hour of riding on the rocky sand or through the royal orchards was her respite. Even then, she was not quite alone, as Vafa, her trusted royal groom, accompanied her, riding a short distance away, respecting her station and her privacy. But the Persians were great believers in fate, and fate set afoot into Vashti's world in the person of a stable groom. One day, Vashti arrived at the stables as usual, her palace guard by her side. As usual, her horse Anush, as well as the groom's horse, were saddled and ready. But her familiar groom was nowhere to be seen. Instead, both steeds' reins were held by a tall young man who appeared both uncomfortable and proud. "Who is this?" Vashti asked her guard. "Where is Vafa?" The eunuch guard, keeping his weapon hand free, approached the young man and interrogated him while Vashti watched. She was fascinated that the young man did not flinch at the inquisition, nor did he appear servile or humble in her presence. His dark eyes swept over her from her black braided hair to her sand-colored split tunic, her small belted waist, her riding pantaloons, to her soft suede riding boots. Vashti stood for his scrutiny. She was not a girl to blush and look away. She was queen of Persia. She was a grown woman. And she was fascinated by this handsome, arrogant groom. In turn, Vashti looked her fill as well. The man held himself like a young prince, starting at the top as he had done, and all within a matter of no more than a few seconds' time, she took it all in. His blue-black hair, his broad and muscled shoulders not quite concealed by his loose tan canvas blouse, the leather belt that rode low on his hips, the tan riding trousers encasing horseman's muscles, tucked into soiled and worn down calf-high boots. And he stood, his proud head of a height, with her horse's forelock, notwithstanding her prized steed's measure, was a legendary nearly 18 hands. The new groom radiated youthful male vigor. His name was Jamshid, and he was old Vafa's 21-year-old nephew. Vafa was hoping the young man, who could ride any horse in the royal stable, would slip into his spot as the queen's groom when it soon came time for Vafa to bow to his age and content himself with tending vegetables in his wife's kitchen garden. Vafa had held Vashti's hand as she had ridden her first pony. He was proprietary about who would assume his duties. And so his nephew was taking over 2 days per week as a trial. Once the queen's guard had vetted him, Jamshid stood aside and in silent invitation held his tan hand palm up at the horse's stirrup, the gesture of courtesy belying the fierce look in his eyes. Vashti walked toward her horse, placed her hand on the saddle pommel, her booted toes in Jamshid's calloused palm, and she vaulted gracefully up. After mounting his own horse, Jamshid respectfully held his steed a horse's length behind the queen's. Vashti's eunuch guard signaled the groom to be off, first issuing his laconic warning, "Watch her." Then the eunuch settled onto the bench in the shaded entrance of the royal stable block. It was time for his morning nap. Looking back, what happened between the queen and the young groom was inevitable. At its most basic, it was a situation where a striking-looking older woman of high social class was powerfully attracted to a strong, silent younger man of lowly station. But of course, this was no ordinary older woman. Vashti was queen of Persia. Perhaps Vashti deserved her few moments of freedom in Jamshid's arms. Perhaps they could have gotten away with cuckolding the king in his own palace. But two consequences followed, one predictable and the other a surprise. Vashti fell pregnant and Jamshid fell in love with the queen. Skip a bit. Okay. section is called A Desperate Queen Vashti. By the evening of the last day of the king's week-long after party, the anticipation among the revelers had reached its apex. Surely the king would summon his royal dancers tonight. The king's strong bearded face was florid with drink. He surveyed the crowded scene through half-closed lids as he leaned back on a maroon-colored damask cushion. He was well satisfied that his show of excess and generosity had achieved its aim. From the murmurs and bows, the smiles and tributes, he was clearly popular, not only with his nobles, but also with the people of Susa. He gauged it the right time to spring his surprise to end the event. Xerxes raised his finger, summoning Mahuman, his chief chamberlain, from his seat nearby. Mahuman bowed his head so he could hear the king's words. Go to Queen Vashti's chambers. She is entertaining the wives at a party of her own, but enough of all that. Now is the time for her to be by my side. You are my spokesman, Mahuman. Bring her this message from her king. Tell the queen that I require her to appear before me now, tonight. She is to come alone, without a retinue, adorned only in her dancing veils. Tell her she must wear her jeweled crown and to let her hair flow free. She will dance before the company and will display her beauty to all. She will give them a treat they will remember every night in their dreams. Her dance will be a gift from their king. Wait for her, Mahuman. Take the other Sarisim with you as escorts. Go now and bring Queen Vashti back with you. So Mahuman tapped the shoulders of his cohorts, all trusted chamberlains to King Xerxes, Bizta, Harvona, Biktan, Agabta, Zitar, and Carcass, and they accompanied him through the scented twilight, over the marble walkways to the women's compound. They had escorted the queen at the king's behest on other nights and to other parties, where she had performed the graceful and powerful Persian veil dance, her lush and forbidden beauty on display for only the one dance, after which she disappeared back to her royal quarters. The seven chamberlains were themselves looking forward to this night's performance, as the queen had not danced for the king since the great banquets had begun 6 months before. A slightly drunk Mahuman rapped on the locked outer door at the southwest corner of the queen's gate. Let us in, Fatima, you old dragon. We have a message for your queen. Old Fatima, the guardian of the queen's chambers, stood in the doorway and blocked Mahuman's way with her draped bulk. You will tell me your message, and I will relay it to the queen. Mahuman smirked as he told her. Fatima longed to smack his face. Wait here, she said. She turned to the enormous guard standing behind her with a spear as tall as he was. Yusuf, watch them. I will go to Her Majesty. Fatima walked quickly to the queen's high-ceilinged dining and entertainment chamber, where the queen was hosting the nobles' wives at her own party. The women were reclining or sitting, smiling and laughing, displaying their bracelets and finery, and telling each other lies about their husbands. Soft notes of lute music played in the background. At their center, on a slightly raised dais, was seated Queen Vashti, watching it all, regal but silent and unsmiling. Her handmaid, Razma's granddaughter, stood as always at her right hand. The women had heard the knocking, and most of them appreciated that this signaled a summons. The room quieted. Old Fatima, who had detected Vashti's intimate secret, but had told no one that she knew except for the queen, now approached her mistress and bowed low, but did not speak. Vashti had gone still at the loud knocking. A strong woman, these past few months she had been terrified, expecting and dreading a summons from the king to dance for him and his drunken guests. With the passage of time and the absence of a summons, Vashti had allowed herself to hope that she might be spared the necessity of a confrontation with Xerxes. But a general's daughter at her core, she had heeded the words of her informant in the king's service that tonight would be the night. And she had prudently used the time to ready herself for the break. The sturdy belted travel bags, the same ones Rosma's grandmother had packed two lifetimes ago while Babylon burned, were hidden and ready. One bag held her treasure and her mother's jewels. The other held her clothing and tiny embroidered swaddling clothes. 2 months ago, she had sent her trusted messenger to Aram, and she now possessed a royal warrant from the Assyrian king in exile, guaranteeing her protection. Her handmaid had this afternoon prepared food parcels and skins of water. The stable was on alert, and her lover, the groom Jamshid, was impatient to leave. Now that the moment of her defiance was at hand, Vashti fought for calm. Treat it just like another performance, she thought. As Vashti's confidant, old Fatima had tended her mistress through the emotional and physical rigors of these past 3 months. A loyal and trusted servant, she knew that Vashti's lovely spine was steel, and that if, as predicted, the king would demand tonight that she dance clad only in her veil and crown, Vashti could not go. Thus, the handmaid was already putting her mistress's escape plan into play. Speak, dear Fatima, commanded Vashti. Your majesty, please forgive the intrusion. Mahuman and the Sarisim are waiting in the vestibule. They have been sent by King Xerxes to summon you to dance the veil dance clad in your jeweled crown with your hair flowing to your waist. They are standing by to escort you there now. Vashti sat immobile, saying nothing but thinking. Xerxes does not bid me to come, as is proper. Instead, as is his wont, he demands that I appear, and he sends his flunkies to escort me like a prisoner or a parcel. It is just as well. I am nothing to him. These will be my last words to him through his messengers. Vashti's face paled, and Fatima wondered if her mistress would faint. Your majesty, Fatima prompted, what shall I tell them? Vashti stood up, her black hair a shining curtain held in place by her hammered gold tiara. I will speak to them myself, Fatima. Vashti stepped off the dais and walked out of the salon. When she stood in the vestibule facing Mahuman and the Sarisim, she looked at each man in turn. They stood by expectantly, assuming they would be escorting her back to the king's party. They were in for a shock. In a clear voice, Vashti said, Mahuman, you may tell his majesty, King Xerxes, that Queen Vashti refuses to dance for the king's drunken friends. Mahuman sobered instantly. In all his years serving Xerxes, he had never heard anyone refuse a royal summons. He also feared having to repeat the queen's words to Xerxes' face, as the king's hair-triggered temper was legendary. Mahuman knew the consequences to the queen could be dire. Who knew what an angry king would do to the messenger? But your majesty, he began, you may go now. Return to the party and repeat to the king exactly what I have told you. The seven speechless Sarisim bowed out of the queen's palace and walked slowly back the way they had come. There was no trace of their drunken camaraderie now. Six of the Sarisim were intensely thankful that it fell to Mahuman to tell the king that Vashti had refused to dance. They truly feared the king's reaction. And they were right. Mahuman and the Sarisim hesitated at the arched entry to the palace garden nearest the king's dais. Mahuman had thought to whisper Queen Vashti's refusal in the king's ear, but the king had spotted his men and was too far gone with drink to be circumspect. Mahuman braced himself. Ah, Mahuman, Xerxes called out. You have done as I told you? The king looked around at the assembled crown in the manner of a monarch about to bestow a surprise gift on his subjects. Well, is the queen making herself ready? Is she come? Mahuman approached the king's table and hesitated. Yes, sire, I mean, no, sire. I did relay your command to the queen herself, but you see, your majesty, the queen is not coming. The area around the king and the Sarisim had quieted. Mahuman pressed on, anxious to finish breaking the bad news. The queen bade me to tell you these words. Tell his majesty, King Xerxes, that Queen Vashti refuses to dance for the king's drunken friends. Mahuman's words fell into the silence, and only a communal intake of breath was audible. Xerxes' face was immobile for a fleeting moment, and then it turned as deep a red as his seat cushion. He stood up, raised his muscled right arm above his head, and struck his scythe scepter down onto the banquet table, splintering the tabletop, smashing crystal and scattering food, wine, and crockery onto his guests. The assembled multitude was motionless with shock and terror. The music had stopped, and even the chittering animals ran for cover and were silent. The king's rages were storied. The visitors in the palace garden, as well as the king's advisors, were at once fearful and fascinated. What would Xerxes do? Xerxes clenched and unclenched his left fist. He was unaccustomed to feeling helpless and humiliated. In fact, he took pains to assure that everyone in his royal coterie was agreeable in the extreme. He had been prepared tonight to revel in the people's gratitude, to watch their slavish appreciation of his queen's beauty. And now, in an instant, and at the whim of a mere woman, he was as nothing in their eyes. All his posturing and generosity would be for naught now. A king who could not even command his queen and be obeyed was nothing but a laughingstock. He was overcome with a desire to throttle and strangle Vashti, and would have done so on the spot if she had had the temerity to refuse him to his face. Unnoticed by anyone, a servant boy in his uniform red cap, white blouse, and saffron trousers bent low and quickly made his way out of the palace garden. He skirted the kitchen tents and melted into the purple night. When he was out of range of the lighted torches, he broke into a run and soundlessly and nimbly climbed the high walls surrounding the queen's compound. On the grass outside the queen's chambers, he whistled a prearranged bird call. Rosamond's granddaughter came to the openwork window covered by an iron grill. "Speak," she said. "They're coming for her now." And the boy disappeared into the night, back to the party. Inside the queen's chambers, all was in readiness. Unconsciously mimicking both grandmothers' escapes a half century before, Vashti and her handmaid were caped and dressed in split tunics and trousers and soft leather boots for speed and travel by horseback. Vashti's old eunuch hefted the belted travel bags. "Come," he hissed. They let themselves out through the camouflaged secret door in the queen's bathing chamber, closing it behind them. Soundlessly, they filed quickly behind the palace walls, skirting the gardens, where they surprised a peacock, ending up behind the stable block. Four horses were saddled, packed and ready, and Jamshid, looking like a warrior, held their reins. He clasped Vashti to him for an instant with his free arm, then boosted her onto Anoush, her familiar steed. "Have you got the king's letter of passage?" he asked. Vashti nodded and patted her underarm, where she carried a secret oilskin pouch. The old eunuch and the handmaiden, in surprisingly agile moves, also mounted their waiting horses, quickly securing the travel bags to the saddle pommels. Only minutes had passed since the servant boy had whistled his warning. Jamshid took point, and the four rode like the wind, heading by prearranged route northwest toward Iran. When the royal guards pounded on the queen's door, the housemaid answered their knock. They pushed past her, and their captain demanded, "Where is the queen?" "Why, she's asleep in her chambers. The women's party ended an hour ago. All is quiet now." "Has anyone entered or left in the last half hour?" he asked. The maid, who knew nothing of Vashti's escape, answered candidly, "No one." The guards, though brutish and arrogant, had not been given leave to harm anyone in the queen's house, especially not the queen herself. They were loath to roust the queen for no reason. After all, she was under house arrest, and their job was to guard the doors and prevent anyone entering or leaving. Any questioning could wait until morning. They looked to their captain, who hesitated. The housemaid, always eager to keep the peace with the king's officers, said, "Would the guards care for some special refreshment? The kitchen staff are drinking tea and having some date cakes before we douse the torches. join us. The captain's decision to drink tea in the kitchen with the pretty housemaid, rather than personally check on the queen's presence, sealed his fate and bought time for Vashti. When it was discovered the next day that the queen had escaped during the night, the guards mounted a search, but they were no match for the combined skill of Jamshid, who rode like a god, the wily old campaigner, and the general's daughter. Vashti and her treasure had simply vanished into the mountains of Mesopotamia. Eventually, she and Jamshid were wed. She had her baby, a boy, who grew up to have spirit and grit, and they lived out their lives in anonymity and comfort in a distant foreign kingdom. And Vashti's name was never again spoken in Persia. Well, now you know the answer to tonight's Megillah mystery, whatever happened to Vashti. I invite you, if you haven't already, to pick up a copy of The Queen and the Spymaster and discover for yourselves the answers to the other mysteries of Megillat Esther. It will enhance your Purim. Thank you all, and Chag Purim Sameach. Have a very happy Purim.
And thank you. Boy, Purim is never going to be the same for any of us.
But people tell me, I have 100 emails from people telling me that. It's great. I hope you liked it.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sandra. And very thank you. Yes, Linda, do you have a question?
No, that's okay.
I didn't get any questions in the chat, but I do have a question for you.
Let's go, Monty.
Sandra. About the cover. Can you tell us something about that piece of art and where we might actually view it?
Okay, so it's, I'll get you the exact, it's written in minute print. First of all, I should tell you that my son, Ben Rapoport, designed the cover of this book and my book, Biblical Seductions. And I found this painting. It had been in the Louvre. It's called A Jewish Girl of Tangiers by Charles Z. Landell. And when I found it, the reason I loved it, other than the fact that it was a Jewish girl of Tangiers, so it was relatively authentic looking, was that half her face was in shadow. And of course I thought it was metaphoric, because of course, one of the guiding premises of Megillat Esther is that nothing is as it seems. Right. And that half the story is overt and half the story is covert.
Yeah.
And so having her partially in shadow, thought just, it was a little bit of Midrash just in the cover of the book. Thank you for asking, but I do love it so much.
Yeah, it's a great cover. Thank you so much. I don't have any other questions in the chat, but if somebody has something they'd like to ask at this point, you can.
And we've also rendered everybody speechless.
I'd like to make a comment. I had known of the book, and it took me a long time to buy it and get to read it, but I read it just a year ago around Purim time. And if you haven't read it already, there are even more surprises, and they're wonderful.
No spoilers, Hazel, no spoilers.
I'm not going to give away anymore. And truthfully, I had forgotten all of this, so I was thrilled to hear it again. And so I do recommend that you read it and enjoy it. As
thank
I
you.
Do.
Thank you.
Thank you. We've got the link in the chat.
Vivian,
I see you. Hello.
Actually, Esther means hidden.
That's correct. Well, Esther, you brought up a good point. Something that's fascinating, and the double meaning of almost everything, it can turn you into a lunatic unless you really just understand that everything in Megillat Esther is meant to have dual meanings. Mm-hmm. So the name Esther, which is very interesting, her name starts out to be Hadassah, which is a myrtle tree. And I explained it all in the book, and you see the meaning of the myrtle tree. funnily enough, she is never referred to as Hadassah ever again in the Megillah. The Megillah refers to only in her Persian name as Esther. And it's really not a Hebrew name at all. It's a Persian name, and it's named after Astarte, which is one of the Persian goddesses. Funnily enough, but not so odd, Mordechai is named after Marduk, who is also a Persian god. And so the two heroes, the two protagonists of this story, who are covert and overt Jew, one is a hidden Jewess, one is an out there, the Ish Yehudi, a Jewish man. Okay, both of them have names that have nothing to do with being Jewish. But what we have seen is that it's interesting that Esther also sounds like the word Hester, which in Hebrew means the hidden. Something that's Hester is hidden or secret. So it's a wonderful play on words, but I'm glad you brought that up because her Hebrew name, the name that she was given after she was orphaned is Hadassah, which is the myrtle tree. And she's never referred to that in the Megillah after it's first introduced when it says Hadassah, he Esther. Hadassah is Esther. And then from there on, only her Persian name is used, possibly because that's how she considered herself. She had to conduct a dual life the way she did. She had to assumed her Persian persona in complete toto.
There's a question from Barry. Barry, unmute yourself. No, what happened to Barry? All right, we'll wait till Barry gets muted. Yeah, okay.
He just unmuted.
Am I unmuted? Okay.
Yes, you're unmuted.
I wonder if you see any similarities between Vashti and Esther.
I was going to ask that.
Well, that's a really great question. Literarily, they're literary foils. But only if you look at Vashti in the view of the Talmud Bavli, which has her as the anti-Esther. In other words, she actually, even in the story of the Megillah, she resisted the king, but she did it overtly. You know, going in, that Esther, as a foil for Vashti, if she resists the king, is going to do it covertly. So when you say to me, do I see similarities? I wouldn't even say the word similarities other than queens. I'd look at them both if I were doing an outline on a blackboard, and I'd see that the action of one would be the non-action of the other, and the non-action of one would be the way the other would behave. You would not have Esther, for instance, the main difference between them is that Esther would not confront the king and beg for her people, or at the very beginning when Mordechai in chapter 4 says, you must go to the king and beg for your people. And she says, well, I can't do that because the law of the land is if you go to the king without permission, you'll be killed. And then she says to him, I will go, but I will do it my way. And it's right at that point, which some teachers will call the fulcrum of the Megillah, when the power passes to some extent from Mordechai, who was doing all the commanding, and Esther doing all the listening, to Esther, who from then on starts commanding. And she tells Mordechai, go to the people, tell them to fast on my behalf. And after 3 days, then I will go to the king. But she doesn't go to confront the king and demand anything. She doesn't anti-Vashti. She goes and says, come to my party. And she stokes his curiosity. And at the party, she says, come to my second party. And she stokes his curiosity. And of course, the brilliant maneuver is that at this party, and there are only three people at each of these parties, it's the queen, the king, and his vizier. So she's not only stoked his curiosity, the king, who is notably paranoid, especially after the assassination attempt, starts thinking, why is Haman invited also to this dinner à deux twice? And from there, you have the Vashti and the anti-Vashti. Vashti acted morally, it's considered she acted morally incorrectly, but she did it overtly. And off she went. Esther knew she had to do it, but she did it her way.